children of all ages, you know what time it is? It's time to worship God. So welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon Water and Hope Church. Get ready to be blessed. So sit back, hang on, and enjoy the ride as we take you out of this crazy world and into a spirit-filled, life-changing gospel show service. Already in progress.
Well, welcome to the saloon. Welcome to Happy Hour. And wear down a person, but that's okay. The Lord's going to fill in for us, isn't he?
Amen.
That's what I figured. Here's an old goodie for you. God tells us of a city so high up above. That song around here for about 100 years. and still get some.
Some.
This one's a newer song, though.
Yeah.
We've been doing it longer,
yeah.
But we just recently started doing it up here, and it's even cooler.
Yeah, it is actually the reason why we are all here. We want more of God's presence in our lives.
Amen. Technical problems here because I got a whole set of new equipment that I'm trying to learn. So, a couple of little snacks, but we'll be all right.
Yeah.
God's going to get us through this.
Amen. And in the meantime, we can just talk a little bit about this song. This beautiful song is, it means a lot to us. And not just because it really, when we practice, every time we do it differently. And every time we are, it's a challenge. But I learn that every time that something really, really matters to God, always the devil is gonna try to rob the joy and rob the blessing. So this is just a time for us to just think about this moment and think about God is here. God is here. Jesus is here. The Holy Spirit is filling this place. And no matter what are we going through, no matter how much are we hurt, no matter how much are we crying and we are devastated, there is Jesus.
Amen.
And he will be always there.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand, I start to fall. And all those lonely roads that I have traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing broken in the broken pieces.
Every minute,
every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. For this man who needs amazing kind of grace, for forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. Well, I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. There was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus on the mountains and the valleys.
There was Jesus
in the shadows of the valleys.
There was Jesus
in the fire, in the flood. Hurting like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it,
there was Jesus.
It was different again.
Nitty Gritty Church Band. All right. Very good. All right. Well, welcome, everyone. Welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon. And for those of you who just may be here for the first time, we always like to start our service out by letting you guys know we are so glad you guys are here. We truly believe God is going to bless you guys today. There is one thing we would ask of you, though, if you don't mind, and that is if you just grab one of these little yellow cards that you see all over the place. And if you would, just throw your name in that. Tell us where you're from. That'd be cool. And then if you don't mind, if you just hold on to this card till the end of the service and write down the bottom in the comment section, tell us what you thought. We're always kind of curious. So if you do that, that would be great. We want to make sure you guys know that we're so glad you guys are here and that you chose to spend your Sunday mornings with us. And so from here on out, you are our guests. So sit back, hang on, enjoy the ride. Everyone else knows there is a couple other purposes for these cards, though, and that is if there happens to be a birthday or an anniversary, or it could be just about anything that you think we got to know about, well, you can put it on this card 1 week in advance. But the main reason we have these cards is for prayer. So if you're here and you have a need in your life, put that need down on this card and give God an opportunity to show himself strong, because prayer does work. Amen? Bible tells us this. Bible tells us that our God is a present help in times of trouble, but it also tells us that sometimes we have not because we ask not. So, again, put your needs down on this card. All right, well, here at the Salvation Saloon, we are a family. Like every family, we try to make sure we recognize each other. And by God, I believe we got us a birthday, don't we?
Hey! Come on! Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
All right, happy birthday, Keisha Cusack. And there is a game that we play each and every week, and it is called Name That Saloonatic. Now, if you are here for the first time, just so you do know, we do call our congregation members Saloonatics. And every week, what we try to do is we try to throw up an old picture, and we all try to guess who it is. And I think I've got a good one for you guys this week. See if see what you guys can do with this. See if you can guess who this Saloonatic is. Guesses? Dave? Dave the water guy. Dan? Well, let's find out. Will the real Saloonatic please stand up? Oh, there it is. It is. It's Dan Noble. Who said Dan? Who was it? Good job. Anyway, whoever it was, good job. You guys did good. Very good. All right. Well, moving right along, we're going to continue on with our service. And what we need to do is obviously we need to start things out right. So we're going to get Billy up here, and he is going to pray God's blessing on this service, and then we'll continue on from there. Here's Billy.
Let go.
I don't. Oh, well. Running around in a desert with a thirsty horse and rattlesnakes everywhere? Nah. I'd rather be in a subway full of rats. But New York City, Queens, what can I tell you? Hey, we're so glad you're here. So good to see some friends here today. Fish is back with us. Good to see you. And my brother Will is here. Will was one of our lead vocalists at the Dream Center. I haven't seen him in person in a long time, but I'm glad he's here with us this morning. So welcome, welcome. So Nancy, who's normally does this for us, was involved in a car accident, so please be praying for her. She's okay, but she did a little bit of damage, so she's kind of on the mend. But hopefully she'll be with us very soon. So keep her in your prayers. So this is the time where we pray God's blessing on the offering, and they're going to be taking it up right now. If you're making out a check, please make it to the Salvation Saloon. And give generously because I'm expensive. Cost them a lot to have me here. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much, Lord, that we can be in your house this morning. God, we thank you for all the blessings that we have, Lord. They're just countless. And we thank you for this family that you created. So, Father, we ask that you be with us this morning, Lord. Bless the gift and the giver. Let it go further and to advance your kingdom here and to help those that are in need. Father, we love you and we thank you for every good thing. Bless Pastor Paul as he comes with the message this morning. Let our ears and our hearts be open to your word and help us to carry it out this week with all those that you put in our path. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, check out this video we got for you.
If I rise, let me rise on you. Not on all of my successes, my esteem or my pursuits. If I lose, let me lose my life. 'Cause if I belong to Jesus, the flesh is crucified. For me to live is Christ, for me to live is Christ, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. If I grow, let me grow in you. Wilt the seeds of wanting more, ripping pride out by the roots. And if I'm still, let me hear you speak. Not the tone of my transgressions, but the song of the redeemed. For me to live is Christ, for me
Amen. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. It's one life to live, it will soon be passed, and only what's done for Christ will last. Amen? All right. Well, today, we're going to begin the book of Jude, or actually the letter of Jude. And I think probably the very first thing that we need to establish is who is Jude. And it's in verse 1 that we actually get our first clue. And so we're going to head right there. And this is what it says. It says, Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James. Well, there are a couple of notable people named James in the New Testament, okay, such as James, the brother of John, who was the author of the three letters that we've just finished studying. But that James and John, okay, also known known as the Sons of Thunder, they were two of the original disciples of Jesus, but they did not have a brother named Jude. But there was another notable... Chuck? Okay. But there's another notable James in the New Testament who did have a brother named Jude, and that would be James, the author of the book of James. And that James and this Jude, they were also two people who were very close to Jesus because as the sons of Mary and Joseph, that made them the brothers of Jesus, or actually more accurately, half-brothers, because again, since Mary was a virgin when she conceived, then we know that Joseph was not the biological father of Jesus. But can you just imagine actually growing up with a brother who was the one and only Son of God? I figured that would have been a pretty tough act to follow, you think? And so that may have attributed, I'm thinking, to maybe a little bit of friction from time to time, maybe a little animosity, some sibling rivalry, which may have something to do when in John chapter 7, it actually told us there that the brothers of Jesus did not believe that he was the Son of God. Now, obviously, someplace along the line, that all changed. Possibly it was when, Jesus started his ministry and he was doing all those crazy miracles, stuff that would have been pretty hard to deny. Possibly that's when things changed. But if that didn't do it, then no doubt it was when they witnessed his resurrection and his ascension, because we do know from that point on they were in. We know that because just after that, in the book of Acts, they were then, the brothers of Jesus, were mentioned as being with the apostles and actually being in partaking in prayer with the apostles. And then it was just a few chapters later in Acts. Is it the cord here? Or? All right. A few chapters later in Acts, it's James who is then stated as being the leader of the church in Jerusalem. And that's really pretty significant because the church in Jerusalem was the very first community of believers to be established. And it was his brother Jude, right, the writer of this letter, who it is believed... believe that he was actually one of those traveling evangelists that John had spoken about in his letters, again, which we have just finished studying. So here's what we got. We got here's Jude, right, the half-brother of Jesus, who it then says, writes this letter to those who have been called, who are loved in God the Father and kept for Jesus Christ. To those who have been called, that's us, who are loved in God the Father and kept for Jesus Christ. Now, when it says there, kept for Jesus, man, that should be pretty encouraging right there, people. Amen? Should be pretty encouraging and also should be something that we need to always be in remembrance of. Because if you guys are like me, there are times. Check. Okay, there are times when we don't always feel very worthy of our salvation. And there's sometimes we even question whether sometimes we're really saved or not. But here's what here's how Jesus actually describes our eternal security in John chapter 6 when he said this. He said, "All those the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive them away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me. For my Father's will is that everyone," check that, "everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have everlasting life." That's an encouraging verse. Amen. And then there's 1 Peter chapter 1 where Peter said this. Peter said, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. And this inheritance is kept," right? It is kept. It is secured in heaven, it says, "for you who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time." So, bottom line is this, people. If you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, right, and that was not just some casual commitment that seemed like a good idea at the time, right, but it was a commitment that's attached to a faith that you are determined to take all the way to the grave, then according to the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 8, well, that makes us more than conquerors. More than conquerors through him who loved us. And that means this, right, as that verse in Romans 8, passage in Romans chapter 8 continues. It means that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen? And so, yes, we're going to screw up and fall short along the way. But since Jesus died to pay the penalty for all those screw-ups, then, as it also says in Romans 8:1, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. No condemnation, people, for those who are in Christ Jesus. All right. I say all this because if you're, you are here and you happen to be feeling some conviction in your life, you're feeling condemned, well, you need to know that doesn't mean that God has forsaken you, right? But what it does mean is this. It means that you need to stop wallowing in that conviction and you need to do something about it, right? You need to deal with that. And how do we deal with that? Well, we deal with that by confessing our sin and then by repenting of that sin. Because when we do that, well, just as it says in 1 John 1:9, our God will be faithful and just to forgive us of those sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen? When we confess our sins, when we repent of our sins, our God is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And if God's word is true, which it is, then that's when it's time to get up and brush ourselves off and get right back to fighting that good fight of faith. Amen? All right. Get right back to fighting that good fight of faith. And then, just as Jude now says in verse 2, and then mercy, peace, and love will be yours in abundance. Mercy, peace, and love will be yours in abundance because there is mercy, peace, and love in a life that walks in obedience to God. Amen? a God from whom all blessings flow. And then in verse 3, Jude now gets into the subject at hand when he says this. He says, "Dear friends, although I was very eager to write to you about the salvation we share, I felt compelled to write and urge you to contend, right, or fight for the faith that was once and for all entrusted to God's holy people." Now, John, who we just read his letters, he urged this very same thing as well, right? He urged the importance of standing firm in the foundational truths of the faith, right? And the reason John urged this is because there were a lot of false teachers at that time that were infiltrating the church, and they were infiltrating the church and then promoting a lot of things that opposed those foundational truths. But here's the thing. That was not just an isolated problem, right? And I think we all know that. And it's now in verse 4 that Jude is going to kind of confirm that when he says this. He says, "For certain individuals whose condemnation was written about long ago, well, they have secretly slipped in among you. They are ungodly people who pervert the grace of God into a license for immorality and deny Jesus Christ as our only sovereign and Lord." So, Jude mentions two heresies here. Two heresies that these false teachers were promoting. And one, which John also mentioned, and that is they denied that Jesus was God, right? That Jesus was God in the flesh. But Jude also mentions here how they were perverting God's grace as being a license to sin. And you know, it is true, actually, that we are saved by grace and not by anything that we have done, and regardless of whether that is good or bad. But still, God never intended us to abuse that grace, right? And that's why when Paul saw this same thing actually taking place in Romans chapter 6, well, do you remember what his response was? His response was, "God forbid. God forbid." Right? Because God did not send Jesus to lay down his life to purchase our forgiveness so that we could then just return to our old life of sin. I mean, that would make no sense at all. But, as Jude said here, there were those who were sneaking in and they were spreading this lie throughout the church, and it was causing problems in the church and it was causing division in the church. Here's how the Apostle Paul actually describes this. From Galatians chapter 5, verses 7 through 9. This is what he said. He's talking to a church. "You were running a good race. You were running a good race, but who cut in on you, right? Or who crept in and influenced you to keep from obeying the truth? Well, that kind of persuasion does not come from the one who calls you." And then he followed that warning by saying this. He says, "A little yeast works through the whole batch of dough." A little yeast works through the whole batch of dough. Which is to say, right, just a little lie in the midst of the truth, well, it can grow and spread, and it can soon have an effect on the whole church. Amen? And so as Jude said, I urge you to contend and fight for the faith. I'm urging you believers to contend and fight for the faith. Defend the faith. And then in verse 5, he kind of lays out his own example here by saying this. He says, "Though you already know this, I want to remind you that the Lord at one time delivered his people out of Egypt, but later destroyed those who did not believe." All right, we know the story, right? God delivered the Hebrew children, right, from 400 years of slavery in Egypt, and he did it by one miracle after another. But then they find themselves in the wilderness, and things started getting a little hard. And forgetting about all those miracles that God had just done, well, there were those that that started to murmur and infect the others with their own unbelief. And the next thing you know, well, you had a whole mess of them that actually wanted to go back to Egypt, right? They were ready to go back into slavery. How about this biblical example in verse 6? When Jude mentions this, he says, "The angels who did not keep their positions of authority but abandoned their proper dwelling, well, these he has kept in darkness, bound with everlasting chains of judgment on the great day." All right, what's this all about? Well, here you got Satan, right, who decides to rebel against God. Okay, we're going way back. Here's Satan. He decides to rebel against God because he wanted to raise his throne above the throne of God. But who is Satan? Well, Satan is the great deceiver, right? He is the father of lies. And so with a little deceptive persuasion, well, what ends up happening is he ends up bringing down a third of the other angels with him, right? Because again, like a little yeast, sin grows and it spreads. And so that's the second example. And then we have verse 7 when Jude says this, in a similar way, right? Little yeast, sin grows and spreads. In a similar way, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding towns gave themselves up to sexual immorality and perversion. And they serve as an example of those who suffer the punishment of eternal fire. Now, I think it's interesting that as it was in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah, well, prophecy says, so shall it be in the last days. And you know what? Sure enough, right? The very same unnatural sexual depravity that existed there, well, it is indeed receiving widespread acceptance today. But here's what Isaiah 5:20 tells us. Isaiah 5:20 says, woe to those who call evil good and good evil. And so just as God dealt with them then, he's going to do it again. He's going to do it again. We know that because prophecy tells us. Verse 8, in the same way, on the strength of their dreams, right, on the strength of their lusts, it says, these ungodly people pollute their own bodies and reject authority. And I believe that would be talking about godly authority, right? Because it's godly authority that is there opposing their sin. And so it says they heap abuse on celestial beings. All right, what might that abuse look like? Well, maybe it would be like in the form of mocking God, right? And denying his existence. Right, because here's the thing, right? If it's God and his moral principles, right, that are standing in the way of the things that we want to do, then the best way to vindicate ourselves would be just get rid of God, right? Just get rid of God, right? No God, no judgment. And then in verse 9, Jude says this. He says, even the archangel Michael, when he was disputing the devil about the body of Moses, did not himself dare to condemn him for slander, but just said, the Lord rebuke you. The Lord rebuke you. And that really sounds like some good advice. Because why would we want to engage in spar with the devil when it's the Bible that tells us that we're to flee from the devil? Right? So just rebuke him in the name of the Lord and move on. Rebuke him in the name of the Lord and move on. And think about this, though, right? Think about if Eve had done that, right? Thinking way back to that story. Just think if Eve had done that instead of carrying on a conversation, right, with the devil. Well, you know what? If she had, we probably wouldn't be in the mess we're in now. Right? Maybe we'd still be in the garden. But women love to chat. All right. I just got shut off there. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said that. All right. Then in verse 10, says, these people slander whatever they do not understand. Well, Bible tells us that. Bible tells us that the natural man does not understand the things of God, the things of the Spirit of God. But, Jude says, the very things they do understand, they understand by instinct, right? Or by their own desires, by their fleshly desires. And so, as irrational animals do, right, animals who just react to their instincts and desires, well, likewise, these people also follow their instincts and desires, and what does that result in? Well, Jude then says it destroys them. It will destroy them. And we're talking spiritually. It will destroy them spiritually. And so in verse 11, woe to them. Woe to them. They have taken the way of Cain. Okay, Cain, whose fleshly instinct of jealousy and anger led him to murder his brother. Right? Or woe to them. They have rushed for profit into Balaam's era, which for Balaam, it was his desire for riches over his obedience for God. And then Jude says that they have been destroyed like in Korah's rebellion. And in Korah's case, it was his desire to rebel against the authority that God had ordained to Moses, right? Which God then defended. God defended Moses. When the earth that Korah and the rebels were standing on, well, it just suddenly opened up and swallowed them all. And so again, as God warned in the Psalms, right? Touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. Because the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. All right, so there, Jude just gave us three biblical examples of how our flesh, following our flesh, will lead to destruction. And so in verse 12, these people are blemishes at your love feast, eating with you without the slightest qualm, shepherds who feed only themselves. They're shepherds who feed only themselves. Well, it was in Ezekiel chapter 34 that the Son of Man said this. He said, woe to you shepherds who take care of yourselves and ignore the sheep, for I will stand against you and hold you accountable for my flock. And to describe these shepherd impersonators further, well, as Jude then says this, he says that they are like clouds without rain, that are blown along by the wind. So, like some passing cloud that promises some needed rain, well, they will deceive people to actually look to them for hope. But there is no hope apart from the truth of God. Amen? And so, like autumn trees without fruit that are uprooted, twice dead, well, they will serve no spiritual benefit. No spiritual benefit. Benefit, but actually just the opposite in verse 13. They'll serve a detriment, because this is what it says. It says that they are wild waves of the sea foaming up their shame. They are wandering stars for whom the blackest darkness has been reserved forever. So to follow them would be pretty much like a picture of the blind leading the blind, right? The blind leading the blind into judgment, right? Like in verse 14 when it says this, it says, Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about them. See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones, coming in verse 15 to judge everyone, and to convict all of them of all the ungodly acts they have committed in their ungodliness, and of all the defiant words ungodly sinners have spoken against him. All right, I like how they kind of list these people as ungodly sinners, because there's actually two kinds of sinners, right? There's the ungodly lost sinners, but then there's the saved and forgiven sinners. Amen? All right, we want to be the saved and forgiven sinners. And in verse 16... just in case you still can't pick these guys out, well, it says this. It says, these people are grumblers and fault finders. They follow their own evil desires and boast about themselves, right? They're even proud about their sins, and we've seen people that that are like that. And it says they flatter others with their own advantage, for their own advantage. So they're also a bunch of brown nosers, right? Because it's all about them. It's all about them. But in verse 17, dear friends, remember what the apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ foretold. And that is in verse 18, they said to you, in the last times there will be scoffers. In the last days there will be scoffers. There will be people who are going to mock the existence of God and who will follow their own ungodly desires, right? Ungodly desires, because they seek to please themselves while us saved sinners, well, we seek to please God. We give it our best shot. And in verse 19, these are the people who divide you. These are the people who divide you. They're the people that create division because they follow mere natural instincts and do not have the Spirit. And again, that is why it's so important, as Jude urged us earlier, to contend and fight for the faith. Amen? Because those who oppose our faith, man, they're all around us. They're all around us. But in verse 20, you, dear friends, by building yourselves up in your most holy faith, you, my dear friends, by building yourselves up in your most holy faith, right, the faith that comes by hearing and hearing of the Word of God, and also by praying in the Holy Spirit, right, because it's that continual communication with God that makes our relationship with Him, right, more personal and stronger. Amen. That communication makes our relationship with God more personal and stronger. Because as it says in James 4:8, it tells us there that as we draw nearer to God, then He will draw nearer to us. So, we're to study the Word, we're to hear the Word, immerse ourselves in the Word, and we're to be in prayer. And that's how in verse 21 it says that you will keep yourselves in God's love as you wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring you to eternal life. Because it's that life, eternal life, that is the hope of this life. It is eternal life that is the hope, our hope of this life. But as we wait, well, we need to be busy. We also need to be busy. We need to be about our Father's business. Like when it said this in Hebrews chapter 6. It says there that God will not forget our work and the love we show to Him as we continue to help His people. The love we show to Him as we continue to help His people. And where to show the same diligence? To the very end. So that what we hope for may be fully realized. So we do not want to become lazy, but we're to imitate those who through faith and patience will inherit what has been promised. What's that mean? Well, it means this in verse 22. It means that we need to be merciful to those who doubt. We need to be there to encourage them. And in verse 23, means that we need to save others, right? By snatching them from the fire. Okay, what's that? That's evangelism, right? That's evangelism. And you know, sometimes we have to approach people in different ways, right? Some people, to snatch them from the fire, well, it may take one of those fire and brimstone messages, right? You may have to scare the hell out of them. That's basically how it is. But to others, it says we may need to just show mercy, right? Mercy and love. Mercy and love, right? Though mixed with fear. Show mercy and love, though mixed with fear. And then it says, hating even the clothing stained by corrupted flesh. And so, okay, you can show mercy and be a sinner's friend. But still, man, don't get so close that their lifestyle could actually threaten to bring you down with them. Let me give you an example of that. It'd be like if you were a former alcoholic who is trying to minister and help out a practicing alcoholic. Well, you know what? You might want to mix a little wisdom and fear in with your efforts. Amen? I mean, makes sense, right? And face it. I mean, let's just be honest with ourselves. We all have certain sins that are attractive to us. And so one of the phrases that I incorporate sometimes in my prayers is this. And to me, this is just, it's always been something very powerful. But this is one of my prayers, and that is to say, Lord, let me love the things you love and hate the things you hate. I want to love the things you love, Lord, and hate the things you hate. And I ask that because I know that my spirit is willing, but my flesh is weak. And so I have to always rely on his strength. Amen? On his strength. Just as it now tells us in verse 24, right? It tells us that we are to look to him. We're to look to him who is able to keep us from stumbling and to present us before his glorious presence without fault. Without fault, right? That's because of the shed blood of a saving name, Jesus. Amen? And so with great joy, in verse 25, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. And that concludes the letter of Jude. Good stuff. Amen. Come on up, Bill. Take it from here.
Morning. So once again, very similar to what we've been studying in John, we get that same message. Be careful who you're listening to, right? You know, in Corinthians, it reminds us that bad company corrupts good morals, right? So it's important what I let in to my head and into my heart and who I surround myself with. So I'm careful because, like Paul said, every one of us has our own things that can draw me back into who I used to be, and I don't want to do that. So I'm careful about movies I watch and records I listen to and stuff like that because it's very easy for me to fall back, and I don't want to ever be who I used to be, right? So I'm careful, and we all should be. Because the devil really, if he can trip us up and keep us from saving someone else, then he kind of wants to win. That's the only way he can win. The only way he can win is if he hurts God. And the only way he can hurt God is to get one of us off track and hurt us. That's his only plan, because we know how the story ends. Jesus wins, right? So if he could take a few of us out, you know, I guess he feels that's a victory for him. So don't be one of them. Be careful what you put in your mind. And some of these crazy people on the internet, don't listen to them. Oh, my God. Please be careful. So anyway, listen, we're so glad that you're here. Welcome to the Salvation Saloon. If you're here for the first time, thanks for being with us. We hope you enjoyed yourself. Hello. Oh, and the comment. Okay. Ooh, that's on. All right, so anyway, those of you that are watching at home, I was not the one that said women yap too much. That was that was Pastor Paul. Send all your comments to Pastor Mr. Paul, care of Salvation Saloon at yahoo.com. Because he loves to get emails. Because I think women just don't talk enough. Mm-hmm. Oh, God. Anyway, so this will help you join us next week. We have some information on the table as you're heading out. There's a page there, a pamphlet there, with some information on baptism. Because we are working on putting together our baptism for the summer. Because we like to do it in the water. We do full immersion in the ocean. And we'd rather do it when it's warm. Because we did one in December, and that was not fun. So we're going to be planning it soon. So there's information on why it's important to do it. And if you haven't done it, or if you did it maybe when you were a baby, but you never did it as an adult, it is really important, and it accomplishes a whole lot. And it really speaks to the people that are there watching. You know, one of the greatest things is we kind of went and made a ruckus, you know, when we used to go with pathways and stuff, and people would come wandering over, what are y'all doing? I mean, it was a production. We had music and food, but we were celebrating our faith, but people were getting baptized and making this expression of the change that had been already happened inside. And it was a really powerful thing for people to see, and it brought a lot of new people to know God. So it's going to be a fun time no matter what happens. And if you're lucky, you'll get to see this year's bathing suit. So you don't want to miss that, because nothing sells bathing suits like this body. Body by Garlic Knots. So anyway, listen, we have a good time here, and we love God, and we love each other. And we're so glad that you're here with us, and we really would like to spend forever with you. And I know that might be a scary thought right now, but we'd really like to be with you for eternity. So we want to make sure that you're in the family, right? That everything we just read today, everything Paul went through applies to you too, because you are one of the adopted co-heirs to the kingdom, right? Sons and daughters with Jesus, co-heirs to that kingdom, because Jesus came and fixed the relationship that we had broken, right? He covered that sin once and for all. And that finished work of the cross was for you and me. So if you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, with me, what in the world? Because with a humble heart and a simple prayer, you can change forever. Say this. Say, dear God, I don't have all the answers, but I know you do. So from this point on, I want to rely on you by accepting Jesus as my Lord and Savior. So please forgive me, make all things new, and by the power of your grace, I will now seek to follow you and serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. So if you've said that today for the first time or the 50th time, but you really meant it, let us know, because we want to celebrate with you. If you're at home, drop us a line. We want to hear about it. We love you. Let me just pray for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this place you provided that we could gather in your name. We thank you for this beautiful country where we live in. We could freely worship you. Lord, we ask that you would bless all the families represented here. Lord, keep us safe so we can once again gather in your house. And Father, as always, we ask that you protect our troops and our first responders. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. We'll see you all next week. We love you.